The presence of mutagenic impurities can be expected in any drug product, which is natural considering that reactive compounds must be used in the route of synthesis. If carried over as impurities, these compounds can also react with the DNA. However, this is not a problem if these impurities are below the safe limits and control strategies are in place. This is regulated by ICHM-7, a guideline which describes 4 different options of control strategies that can be adopted for mutagenic impurities. To know more about these options, watch our previous video about ICHM-7. Among them is option 4, which is where the purge factor concept is introduced. The purge factor is a calculation that shows us the extent to which the manufacturing process is capable of eliminating a certain impurity, separating it from the API. When we can show a safe purge factor, we don't need to generate analytical data, which means many hours and resources can be saved by pharmaceutical companies. The purge factor approach is becoming more and more acceptable by regulators since it is based on scientific knowledge instead of simply relying on analytical data. And how do we calculate the purge factor? It takes into consideration the properties of the impurity, such as reactivity, solubility, and volatility, and the stages of the manufacturing process. So first, we need to know our impurity. In which conditions is it reactive? Is its solubility different from the APIs? What is its boiling point? And second, we need to know our manufacturing process. The conditions used in each stage must be considered because every stage which separates the impurity from the API or its precursor intermediate will contribute to the purge factor. The property that will cause the purge depends on the stage. To reaction stages, we must consider the reactivity and volatility factors. To workup stages, such as extraction, centrifugation, filtration, and washing, the solubility factor must be considered. To drying stages, only the volatility factor can be considered. And which factor can be attributed to each purge? Some recommended values have been published by Andrew Teasdale and colleagues in this paper and have been used by the pharmaceutical industry in the calculation. According to this publication, when a stage can purge the impurity through reactivity, the highest factor that can be given is 100. For solubility and volatility, the highest is 10. This shows how conservative the calculation is, which explains its acceptance by regulators. If a stage cannot separate the impurity from the API, a purge of 1 is given. After we know the purge factor for each stage of the process, we simply multiply all factors to get the predicted purge factor. Then, we need to check if it is enough compared to the required purge factor. If we know the amount of the impurity we started with and how much we must end with to achieve the safe limit, we know how much we need to purge. So the required purge factor is the initial concentration of the impurity divided by its safe limit. The amount of impurity introduced can be calculated based on the details of the manufacturing process, and the limit can usually be calculated based on the acceptable intake and the maximum daily dose of the API. The acceptable intake can vary depending on the treatment duration. When we compare the predicted purge with the required purge, we get the purge ratio, which is the most important result when we want to show elimination of a certain impurity. The purge ratio is the predicted purge divided by the required purge. Depending on the result of the purge ratio, this paper by Chris Barber and colleagues proposes which additional data would be required to meet ICHM-7 option 4. If this ratio is any value higher than 1,000, it means that the process is capable to purge the impurity 1,000 times more than it would be needed to achieve the safe limit. Hence, option 4 can be used without the need for any experimental data. If this value is between 100 and 1,000, option 4 can also be used, but it would be recommended to present supporting information for key purges or even non-trace analytical data such as solubility measurements or HPLC data from reaction monitoring, for example. If the value is between 1 and 100, stronger evidence should be provided to support the option 4 approach. This could be, for example, spike and purge studies. This is when you intentionally add big amounts of the impurity to a stage and measure it in a later on stage, evaluating how much the stages in between actually purge and eliminate the impurity. This is the best way to prove how much the process purges an impurity, especially because the purge factor calculations without experimental data are highly conservative. And if the value is below 1, it means that option 4 is probably not the best control strategy, and one of the other options presented in ICHM7 should be used, 1, 2, or 3. So let's see an example. Let's say that the mutagenic impurity is an alkyl halide, and it has the following properties. For reactivity, we should consider conditions when alkyl halides are reactive. Its solubility in this case will be similar to the APIs, and its boiling point is 80 degrees. Keeping the above properties in mind, we then look at the stages of the manufacturing process. We must present a scientific justification for each and every purge that is given. This impurity is the starting material of the manufacturing process, and after its introduction to the process, we first have a reaction with an amine to generate an intermediate. In this stage, the reaction conditions are ideal for consumption of this impurity. It is highly reactive with amines, which is well described in the literature. So a purge factor of 100 can be given for reactivity. The temperature of 60 degrees is below the impurity's boiling point, so it will not volatilize. Hence, a factor of 1 is given for volatility. In the extraction, the impurity remains in the same liquid phase as the next intermediate. Hence, this does not separate one from the other. The solubility factor is then given as 1. In the precipitation, the impurity is not precipitated, and this may have been proven through experimental tests. Hence, a solubility factor of 10 is given. In the filtration stage, the same reason described above applies, but as a conservative approach, the solubility factor is given as 3 instead of 10. For washing, the same applies, and the solubility factor is given as 3. In the drying stage, at 120 degrees, a volatility factor of 10 is given, because the temperature is more than 20 degrees higher than the boiling point of the impurity. The next one may be a reaction where the alkyl halide is not reactive, however, it will volatilize a little in the temperature of 85 degrees, which is 5 degrees higher than its boiling point, so the volatility factor is 3. In the precipitation stage, the impurity cannot generate its salt form, so it is not precipitated. Hence, this stage separates the API from the impurity and a solubility factor of 10 is given. For filtration and washing, additional solubility factors of 3 are given. And finally, since the drying temperature is more than 20 degrees higher than the boiling point of the impurity, a volatility factor of 10 is given. To get the total purge factor, we multiply the individual ones. So, in this case, when we multiply all those values, we get a predicted purge factor of 243 million. But what does this mean? What was our required purge factor? To calculate the required purge factor, we need the initial concentration of the impurity and its acceptable limit in the API. Since the impurity is the starting material, we start with 100%, which is 1 million ppm. And the limit is calculated as follows. Let's say the maximum daily dose of the API is 300 milligrams, and this drug is for chronic use, that is, used for more than 10 years. So the safe limit is the acceptable intake, which is 1.5 micrograms, divided by the dose in grams, so 0.3 grams. This gives a limit of 5 micrograms per gram, that is, 5 ppm. If we start with 1 million ppm and we want to end with less than 5 ppm, our required purge factor is 200,000. And what is the purge ratio? The predicted purge factor divided by the required purge factor. 243 million divided by 200,000. 1,215. This means that the process can purge the impurity 1,215 times more than it would be necessary. Since the purge ratio is higher than 1,000, option 4 can be justified with no need for further testing. This is only an example of how the purge factor can easily show that the manufacturing process is designed to eliminate a specific impurity and that there is no need to develop and validate analytical methods. In this case, we did the calculation manually. However, an in silico tool has already been developed to help in this prediction. Mirabilis is a software described in this paper by Michael Burns and colleagues, which helps the industry to standardize their calculations, besides giving automatic reactivity factors for a series of reactions which are within the knowledge base, built by a consortium of experienced chemists. Either way, the advantages of the purge factor are evident. Besides saving a lot of time and resources which would be spent in analytical testing, we also have a strong technical and regulatory argument for the safety of the API regarding mutagenic impurities.